Hey guys, this is the Cognac Conversations podcast, and we are going to need you guys to prove your love for us.
Exactly. So therefore, like, comment, and subscribe. Doesn't make sense. Subscribe. Doesn't hurt. Take a couple of seconds, man. Love us like we love y'all.
And like they said, man, do what you got to do, and we on to the video.
All right, happy hump day. This is Ashley Laguerre, and we are in Jersey City. And I am one of the three P's in the pod. This is the Cognac Conversations. And to the right of me, I got Rick the Ruler. I know I fucked it up. I know. Don't even say
it. I let you rock. Go ahead.
We got Rick the Ruler to the right of me, aka yep. Bucket Hack Daddy.
You know
AKA
it.
AKA Rick. Yep. And then we got Spread Media. Thank you, Dupe. Dude was a little late today, so I'm right there. He's doing it. And then we got...
putting everybody on blast? That's how your intro going? You putting
everybody on blast? Yeah, why not? You guys put me on blast in the meeting. So we all right. We rolling. This is what happened tonight. And then we got J&S Media. Thank you, George. We got our part-timer, Alex. And to the left of me, PTA we got Savi, a.k.a. Suavemente.
Hey, good afternoon, good night, good morning, depending on you guys are watching from. We got a very special guest. It's a very special guest today. My good guy, Jersey native man. My boy, Pressure Online.
PressureOnline.com.
My
God.
What's up, man? What's going on, bro? How's everything, man?
Everything's good, man. Life is good. You know, we living.
My man, bro. I'm glad to hear that, bro. Felt like I ain't seen you in a very long minute, bro.
Very. I've been staying out the way, man.
Word, that's good, bro. Out the way is a good thing, bro.
I used to be in the way, but now I'm out the way.
There you go.
It's hard to do nowadays.
Yes, it's hard to do nowadays.
It definitely is, bro. Yo, my man, I see that you just dropped the album, too, by the way.
Yeah, 29.
29, my man. 29. 7 tracks in there.
Yep.
Ooh, I see a good little... things that you got some producers in there too. I saw my boy Jugs in there as well.
Shout out to Jugs, bro. He produced 2 things in
there. Right. And I think was it DJ Wala is in there too?
Yeah, shout out to DJ Wala. Yeah, we got him on. Ooh. Featured on Jugs.
My man, bro.
I remember the motherfucking Wild Out parties going to them bitches like
Wild
shit.
Out parties used to be wild, bro.
Yeah, facts. Yep.
Definitely, bro.
You
man.
Still do them?
What?
The parties.
Does he still do the parties?
Wild Out parties?
Yeah.
I mean
Walla is like that.
He does do like back in the day type shit. Where yo, he definitely did.
What's the shit Walla used to do back in the day, dude?
Robert Tree Hotel.
Robert Tree.
Yeah.
Now it's another spot.
I'll be honest with you though.
Yeah.
It's another spot. I was too young to get in. So I found out as me and him got cool and people would talk about it all the time, but
damn.
I couldn't even get in there.
What the fuck?
Bro.
Terrace Ballroom.
That's what it is.
Terrace Ballroom. Hey yo, shout out to Walla. Walla did the Terrace Ballroom. Shut that bitch down. Every fucking time. Used to bring out celebrities, all that shit before that shit was big. Yeah. Celebrities wasn't fucking with Jersey like that before. No. All over,
factual,
bro.
Factual.
Terrace Ballroom was the spot, though. Shout out to Walla for that shit, though, for real.
Yeah, man. Yo, crazy enough is, fuck it. So, what you got? You have 3 albums out right now, right? If I'm not mistaken?
Yeah, like officially.
I know you got a lot of mixtapes, though, for a fact.
Oh, yeah.
I know for a fact you do.
I definitely was barring for years. But, yeah, 3 projects. I mean, Silent Screams, the first one, that was in 2014.
Yeah.
It was an original project, but I never really considered it like an album. My first one, I would really say, is like Fear.
Fear.
Fear was in 2020. Transparent, I dropped at the end of 22. Transparent is an EP, and then 29, which I just dropped over the summer of 23.
Whew. Yo, I see Silent Screams, bro. You had... Fred Godson, God rest his soul, bro.
Yeah, rest in peace, Fred Godson. That's my guy.
Yo, yep. How was he as an individual, bro?
Amazing. It's times that I would call him randomly, like when I hear K Slay and rest in peace, K Slay. It's times I would hear K Slay like go crazy with his freestyles, whatever he had, and I would call Fred like 12 in the morning, like yo, Drama King going crazy on your joint. Like he was a real down to earth person. Be honest with you, I don't even know if I said this on another podcast, but. Me and him actually have an unreleased record, me, him, and Ransom.
It's crazy.
Oh shit, right? Oh,
yeah,
that's what's up. Ransom tough as hell too.
Yeah, shout out to Ransom. Jersey.
Bars. Yes, he is.
But yeah, man, Fred was a great guy, man. Very approachable, very understanding, good with business.
Yeah.
A good father from what I've seen, you know, but he was a great guy, man. Very, very relatable.
Oh, word, that's great to hear, bro.
So what, you got something?
Oh, no, I was going to say, because he passed from COVID, if I'm not mistaken, right?
Yes, yeah, in the early stages.
Yeah. Yeah, so, you know, God rest his soul, bro. I was going to get into, because, of course, you think about COVID, somebody passing, you see about somebody, like, on a bed, bro, like an emergency bed, like the little things that
on
they
the
have
ventilators
out there.
And stuff
yeah,
like that.
Man.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And they clicked. I was like, damn, because your album, Fear, is a picture of you in there, like very not similar. We don't know how he looked at the time though, but I'm saying you were in there.
Yeah.
And like, what was that about though? The whole.
Yeah. So, back in March of 2017, my right lung collapsed.
Oh.
For those that don't know, I don't smoke. You know, and it's crazy how it happens, because a lot of times when people lung collapse, it's usually like from smoking or like a traumatic impact,
right,
such as shot, stab, car accident,
yeah,
whatever. Right. In my case, it was random, and it was called spontaneous pneumothorax. At the time, I didn't even know what that meant. That was like a big periodic table cinematic word.
Word up.
I'm like, hey, what? But yeah, man, this specific day, my chest just felt loose, like somebody like unscrewed my chest, and I remember jogging up the steps to my crib, and I felt my chest like
oh
I had hydraulics
God.
Or something random. This was March 29th, 2017, and when I got home, my cousin Taylor Port, shout out to Taylor Port, she was there, and she was like, "Yo, go to the hospital." And I was like, all right. She's like, I'll go with you. So she went with me. My mother was at the crib. It was a couple people that was at the crib, but Taylor went with me to the hospital. Mm. And they ran tests. They did x-ray, EKG, the regular. And they didn't see nothing. And, you know, when you're in the hospital after a while, you know how I go, 2-3 hours emergency room,
yeah,
you start feeling better.
Yeah, that's
yeah.
true.
Like, I'm yeah. good.
I'm good. Let me get out of here.
For sure.
Exactly.
And then what happened was... it was this one specific nurse. I do not know her name, but I wish I did, because she played a big part. She was like, I want to do another test on you. Mad random, right? So I'm like, all right, what's up? So she wanted to do an ultrasound on my chest. And in my mind, I'm like, that's for pregnant women. So I'm like, come on. Like,
exactly.
What are we doing?
Word.
She did an ultrasound on my chest. And when she was rubbing the gel on my chest, she was bad, by the way. She was bad.
Mm. Hey, so,
you know,
oh
I like her.
You know what I'm saying? The nurse joints be bad as a bitch.
With the scrubs, boy, this shit a little fatty.
Yeah.
You know
yeah.
what I'm saying? But, you know, shout out to Beth Israel. got shot at the hospital. yeah, so she rubbed the joint on my chest, and she put the joint, that reads your joint. So she doing it. She like, I don't see your heart. And then she put more and she went lower.
Wait, she said she didn't see your heart?
Exactly. I know that happened too fast, right?
Word.
When she said that, me, I play a lot. So I'm like, oh, that's because it's higher from you. I'm shy.
So you still trying to get the joint?
Hey, yo. Trying to bag the nerves.
Trying to bag the joint.
I'm
about to die.
Mama, I'm talking crazy. So when she go lower, like under my chest, she sees my heart. And it's not supposed to be there.
Right.
She like, why is your heart so low? And because of that extra test that we did, that saved me from leaving, because me and my cousin Taylor was going back and forth. She took my car keys. I was like, man, I'm ready to go. I'm ready to get up out of here.
Right.
I don't even want to sign up discharge papers. I'm leaving.
Yeah.
And luckily she took my car keys, because that test right there is what saved me from leaving. And then when the doctors came and they was like, yo, your heart is out of place. It looked like air pressure is trapped. And what it did was it separated my lung from the wall, so it allowed fluid to hug my lung like a balloon, right?
Yeah.
The
infiltrating the shit, just inflating that bitch.
Exactly. Oh. So the compression was the reason why I was feeling what I was feeling. And, you know, so my mind was like, how do we fix this? Is it a pill, something I drink? And he's like, nah, we got to put a chest tube in you.
I'm
confused, because I've never been hospitalized, none of that. Always been healthy, athletic. So I remember them just calling my mother, my father, family. It's people coming up to the hospital now because now people don't know what's happening. Like, right. It's getting serious now. Like, all the jokes is out the window. Mind you, this is like a 4-hour timeline that I'm trying to compress into one. But everybody came through, and they pretty much had me sign off these papers. Like, they was going to cut my side about as small as a pinky fingernail. Mm. Like, they had to cut my side, like, in a plus type of form. And, yo, they had to hold me down. I seen them coming all suited.
They didn't
up.
Put you to sleep?
No, they couldn't because it's dealing with my respiratory. So, they gave me awoke. You know what I'm saying? To actually communicate and do what
exactly.
The only thing I remember was they gave me 3 shots in my rib cage while I'm awoke. I'm talking about these needles as long as like however.
Them Epidural shots.
Yeah.
those long shits.
They told me not. They told me to sit still.
They told you not to.
They told me to sit still. Just to fast track it, they held me down and they told me count to 3 and inhale as much air as I could. And when I tell you, when they counted down to 3, they shove that chest tube up in me. They holding me down, my body rocking, and they pushing it. They cutting through the muscle.
And you feeling all this shit.
Everything. It's going through my chest. I'm like, they're going to hit something. I'm, right. I'm paranoid.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, they got that thing up in me. And, you know, I was mentally, I was like, yo, it's over. Like, I couldn't even believe this was happening to me. So, you know, once they got it in, they sealed it, locked it in. And then as that's happening, my mother's there. And she's taking one thing about my mother, she will put you on her Facebook, anything. Oh, she's going to take a picture of anything.
right.
She's taking pictures. And honestly, that picture you saw wasn't a reenactment or no Photoshop.
Oh,
that was
wow.
The real picture of when they was tying my side to lock in the tube.
Oh, the cover. So the cover art was the
actual. That's a real picture. Only thing I did was put like a, because I designed the cover, I put like a little scratch filter on top of it and just added my name. But that was the real picture from what really happened.
Damn, like, salute to you, bro. Because I don't think a lot of people can fucking sit there and then just feel that pain and just still be coherent enough to understand what's going on. Salute to you, bro.
Really. They pushed that joint through, and I told my air shot out my side, like, I didn't even know how the human body operated. Right. Yeah, that changed me forever.
Yeah, man. How was the recovery time, though? Like, what was the aftermath of that?
I had the March 29th, which I have a song on that album called March 29th, and I actually give a detail of how the day went.
Right.
I went on, that was a Wednesday. The chest tube, they took it out on Sunday, and then I left Monday. So it was 4 days. I had the chest tube, and I had to stay the extra day. But bed rest, I couldn't get on the flight. I couldn't go on the water too low. Yeah. Anything dealing with a different level of pressure, I couldn't. Or my lung possibly could, you know, pop or anything.
Yeah.
No pun intended, though. Your name's pressure, though.
Yeah, I'm about to say.
I'm about to say
no pun intended.
Nah, for
sure.
And yo, that crazy shit, though, that stuff that happened to you, that's my birthday, March 29th.
Oh,
it is,
my God.
Oh, yeah, it is. Definitely is.
That's wild,
and
bro.
I got the number tatted on me now because I was born July 29th, and this happened March 29th. So 29 is a special number to me.
I feel that. I was into, I'm like, the fuck.
Yeah, that's wicked.
Wow.
But how fast did your life change after that? Like, immediately, what were the things that they were telling you that you couldn't do? And like, were they telling you that, like, you could die if you do X, Y, Z?
Well, what happened was, originally, I was scheduled to go on to a college tour right before this happened. Like, literally, like, a week before.
Yeah.
So, obviously, I couldn't get on no flights. Like, and I was mad, you know? Like, when you young and your life comes to a pause, you know, the recovery for someone younger is harder because we're more active.
More ambitious about
older,
shit.
Sit still.
Yep. Right.
But in my case, man, I was just tight about it. But it definitely changed my life because it made me want to eat different. You in that hospital, I'm talking about everything they was giving me had no flavor.
Oh, my God.
But you want to go? You're like, man, give me them mashed potatoes tasting like clay. I'm taking it.
Exactly.
You know what I'm saying?
Because you want to get back right.
Yeah, so, you know, it changed me, though. It changed the way I eat. I had started working out and really just paying attention to people I was around, like secondhand smoking and stuff.
Right. Yeah.
It definitely changed, like, my environment, because I had to think about a lot and look at what's at risk, and I had to look at what's the possibility of this happening again.
True that. Yeah.
So, does other people smoking around you affect your condition?
I would say no. Even when I went over this with the specialist, the lung specialist, he was saying that the chance of this happening again is like under 15% for my age and all of that. So I knew I was in a good space, but I was in the clubs a lot. You know, I was working. I was doing a lot of different things that I was around smoke. And, you know, in this game, you know, you could be in a studio session and to tell people to put their smoke out so you could do your verse is like crazy. So it definitely made me record more at home and send out verses. Like, it changed things for a little bit. But it's a paranoia.
Was there, like, any people around you that you felt like weren't sensitive to your condition and, like, the changes that you had to make?
No, I'll be honest with you. Yeah. I'm a fortunate person that I've given respect for so long that I've always received it. And people that was around me and still around me, you know, we have a mutual love for each other that, you know, they wouldn't want to be the cause for me going through that again because nobody liked to see me like that.
Yeah.
So, honestly, I didn't have those insensitive run-ins. You know?
So, I got a kind of a two-part because I guess prior to the situation that you had, you was always locked in and tuned into music. And you was already putting out music. So, my first part of the question is, what got you to the point where you were like, yeah, I'm ready to do this thing. I want to put out music. And two, did the way you did your music and stuff change after the fact of this serious situation?
Okay, so first part, how I got into music.
Yeah.
Shout out to my Uncle Pistol. Oh, God rest his soul. He passed away in 2014. Mm. When I was younger, I say like 2003, 2004, my Uncle Pistol, at the end of every school year, I used to take a trip down Maryland. I used to go stay down there with my aunt for like a week as soon as I get out of school. And going on that road, he would always play mixtapes, you know, G-Unit mixtapes, all of that. This is how I became like a great fan of Lloyd Banks, you know.
Right.
And then shout out to my Aunt Vic. I remember being downtown Newark, which is a city in Jersey, for those that don't know. They used to sell bootlegs down there in the early 2000s, right? So there was a CD that had 50 Cent on it. And G-Unit, my favorite rap group. Lloyd Banks, my favorite rapper. Nobody can't tell me nothing, right?
So
what happens is I see a CD of 50 Cent that say 50 Cent instrumentals. At this time, I'm like 11.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I'm going back to the younger days. So at this time, I didn't even know what the word instrumentals meant. I'll be honest with you. Right. I knew what beats meant.
Right.
Right. If somebody present instrumentals, you like, what the fuck is going on?
Beats, right. Yeah. 50 Cent instrumentals, right? And I look at the track list and they got all the greatest songs of 50 at this time. So I'm like, I want this. We pop it in the whip.
No lyrics.
He like, I know the bootleg ain't take the vocals off. I'm lost. We on the road. No, I'm serious. I don't even know how to explain this. I'm like, damn, this was $3.
Yes.
I got $3 worth of beats.
We're old.
So exactly. Check out. This is the crazy part. My aunt ready to bring the CD back, but me being such a fan, I'm like, nah, I keep it. Brought it home, and I remember saying their lyrics over the beats, like performing it in the mirror with the brush, you know, classic stuff.
Right.
And then it got to the point where I was like, man, let me twist this how I want to say it. And then I always loved poetry, so I always kind of knew how to write. I just never knew, like, the formats of 16 bars and all that. So with me having that instrumental CD, and then with my uncle always playing these mixtapes and all that, it just taught me, like, damn, I want to rap, and I just want to spit punchlines. So that's kind of going back to how I started, and I recorded my first song. It was called Champ Is Here. Shout out to Richard. I'm talking about, this was so long ago. It was on a floppy disk.
Oh, the little joint you plug into the hard drive.
Yeah. People don't know about that. Like,
yeah. You probably exactly.
I'm about to say, that's before niggas' time.
You never
that's
had before, a floppy disk.
I'm talking about, that's before LimeWire. Like, these are young people watching.
Yeah, right.
Yeah,
you better not be watching this if you ain't never had a floppy disk.
Motherfuckers don't know about the floppy disk.
Yeah. That's what I'm saying. Like, you know, so being around at that time and learning, and you know what I mean? It just made me want to just keep learning, you know. And then I was introduced to these multi-platinum producers by the name of Dream Team by the time of 2008, and they had me create this song. It was called What It Do. That was like my first official video, green screened out. And at this time was 2009. I'm trying to think. I was in high school.
I remember you showed me that video, bro.
Yo,
yeah,
it was a long time ago. So you know, things like that just made me interested in the craft. And, you know, I got into camera work and just bouncing around. And honestly, it just kept me in the game. It just kept me doing things. There's times I took breaks, but, yo, it was an amazing start. You know, it's very different.
Right.
Very different start out.
Would you say, like, you have a very eclectic taste in music, or, like, a wide variety taste in music?
As far as what I listen to or the type of music? Okay.
Do you listen to Taylor Swift?
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah.
No,
Swifties?
No, what would people be surprised that you listen to?
Like a certain genre. Like, look, if somebody be like, oh.
Like, they would never, to, something you would bump, like, when you're by yourself. Like, what, you know.
Watch this.
Someone can't hear
this
you
singing. This
gonna
bug you out. You ever heard of a guy called...
Wait, don't play it though, bro.
Yeah.
Don't
play. No, as long as he can...
that's all good.
He can play for the room and they can't.
Scotty McCreary.
Scotty McCreary.
Sound like some country shit.
He got a song called Feeling It. Yo, when I tell you...
Feeling It.
It's country.
Okay.
I knew it was country.
Okay, we here. That name. We here with the country.
I love country music.
Really?
Hey, yo.
I don't know how,
I told you, bro. I would not have took... If you would have told me... You would have said that name from the jump, I'd have been like... Nah, you don't know about him.
Bro,
I hate that country shit.
Yo, I can't listen. No, no way. It's probably it. One song I could probably. I don't even know
my
it.
Like songs. I'm typing
it
in
is.
My like songs.
It really is.
It really is.
No, because I get my days where I like trap. I like, you know, beat. Yo, listen.
Yeah.
I'm around it so much, I be wanting something different. That's like, respectfully saying, because I don't know who in a relationship here, but that's like dealing with the chicks that you meet all the time at the bar. They out. They got the same motive you got.
Mm-hmm.
It's a time where you actually want a lady that you just can't run into.
Sometimes you want a conversation.
It's the same thing with music. I want to hear somebody say something that's simple. Like, if you heard this song, this guy is saying... The Ray Bans is raying, dang, dang, same, bang, bang, and then my cousin.
I like that.
Hear that.
Yeah.
I don't know why.
Hey, bro, would you ever do a country song?
Of course
you
I
wouldn't
would.
You would?
Oh, I've done pop. Oh, yeah, I'm about to say Nelly did that. Nelly jumped into that lane for sure.
He got a song called Over It.
Yes. Over Again.
And then Dirk also went
with Dirk did too.
Tim McGraw, yeah.
Sure. That's what I'm saying. Like, I know music because. Like, I listen to gospel. I listen to all types of music. It's certain artists they actually make the... If it feel good, I like it. I'm not biased, and I'm like, this is my lifestyle, so I can't listen to that. Like,
so you don't fashion yourself into a certain lane. You don't tell yourself, listen, I'm gonna just make trap beats. I'm gonna make this type of shit. I got the air for music.
Exactly. Good. No, even if people in the room or that's watching is not familiar with my music, like, every project even changes because I'm writing about experiences. Like, obviously, you go through different things as you get older, as you walk into different rooms. If your music is not changing and what you're saying is not changing, then that means you're not growing.
True. Yeah. Very much so true.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I'm not going to hold you, bro. There's a lot of people that just in general is very diverse, bro. Like, besides, like, JNS and Spread Media and stuff, Jugs, he's one of them, too. He does a lot of things. But
shout out to Jugs.
Pressure, too, bro. Pressure's not only a rapper. Like, yeah. I know you do producing a little bit.
Just a creator, bro.
Just
a creator.
And that's a lot. You got a lot of stuff underneath your belt, bro. So that's fucking fire to hear that.
I'm thankful,
though,
man. And how it happened was, it was a time where I wasn't financially stable to support myself, so I obviously couldn't pay people to, you know, help me out. So I had to be on YouTube. I had to have run-ins and do certain things to teach myself to the point that I didn't have to keep asking for it.
Right.
You know, so that's the reason that I kind of got into everything. You know?
I think one thing that a lot of people blind themselves to is the hustle. A lot of motherfuckers don't really... except the fact that these motherfuckers blew up, but you got to understand the hustle that was behind it.
Yeah.
You get what I'm saying? Nice. Like, you know where you came from. You know what you did. But a lot of motherfuckers just see the end of the road.
Of course.
But the hustle, and I respect that from you, and after all you went through, the hustle game is very great from you, bro. And I respect that. But
appreciate that, man.
A question that I had was... knowing that you are a creator, artist, and everything, is there an artist that is present? Well, again, a two-part for me. Okay. Is there an artist that may have, that's not with us no more, that you may have wanted to work with, and there's the artist right now that's like going that you may want to just click up with and just make some greatness with?
For sure. An artist that's gone that I would have loved to make music with. We talking mainstream?
Whatever you want to do.
Whatever floats your boat.
Whatever, yeah.
I don't know how, you know, far-fetched this might sound, but it would have been Michael Jackson.
MJ.
MJ. Yeah, of course. I think Mike Hood.
People never really pay attention, but Mike is
Mike got pictures throwing up.
When you listen to the lyrics,
He was throwing up. He was thugging.
But you know his voice, that wasn't really, he was always faking that voice. I don't know if you guys knew that. His voice, what you hear, and like how he spoke to, like very soft.
He changed the shit up.
I don't like to say faking because
we're not faking it, but that was the look. That was he was going for.
Yeah, he had to perpetrate away.
Definitely Mike though. I feel like Mike was probably one of the most popular human to ever live. You know, like he's so iconic in a different way. Like if you don't say Mike in your top five, like that's crazy. I know some people think I would go for a hip hop artist, but Mike is known in Asia, Africa. Like, it's a different global level of streaming you would get with a regular mic.
Word.
So definitely Mike. As far as alive right now, my typical answer would be Lloyd Banks. But just to leave him out of it, just because he's my guy and that's common sense, I say right now J. Cole.
J. Cole?
Oh, yeah. That would be a fire. So,
I'm so happy that you said Cole because Cole's one of my favorite rappers right now. T.I. has been my favorite rapper since it was introduced to T.I., but J. Cole's one of my favorite rappers now. So just to transition off to that, I know we got some stuff that we want you to get into. We want you to give your opinions on, but I'm going to just jump the gun. So I know you heard the first Shooter Mode with J. Cole and Drake. Then you heard the Scary Hours, I forgot what was the name of that song?
Evil Ways?
Yeah. So, not putting you on the spot, but I'm going to put you on the spot.
Let's do it.
Listen to both of their raps, listen to both of their bars. The competition in you, who you think got the best of that on the tracks?
On First Person Shooter, J. Cole.
Okay.
I think Drake got off at the end of the song. Like, I think that was his moment.
Do you feel like he had to change the beat up for him to have to get off on the song? Because J. Cole murdered it. Mm-hmm. There's no way you can come back from that.
Yeah, definitely. As far as the Evil Ways, I'll be honest with you, I haven't really sat still and dissected it enough to give a real opinion. But that First Person Shooter, J. Cole, hands down. He moonwalked on that joint forward. Like, he did something else. I like what he did on that.
Right.
Yeah, I ain't gonna hold you, bro. That second one he put out with J. Cole started off, it goes over a couple people's heads. He said, me and Drake about to link up, like you about to free the slaves. So I don't know if you guys caught that shit.
No, I caught it.
You caught it?
Yeah, I caught it.
What you got for that?
I'm just as a mass person listening to it, I just felt like a nigga had to get their lick back.
No.
You talking about the actual
so he say Lincoln, like free the slaves,
yeah. Bro, I talk about that second bar,
and that's like the very first. I'm like, damn,
that's how you felt. Nah. I'm with you on that, yeah.
Bro, I was really like in dissecting that shit. I'm like, yo, what the? That's the very first thing he says, though, bro.
But you gotta understand, he had to stand, he had to live up to.
Oh, of course, bro.
You get smoked, you gotta live up to the standard.
I mean, yeah, man. It's very. We spoke about this a little bit. They are very different, you know. I feel like one is a natural born like artist, and another one is just strictly a rapper and whatnot. So like, but the thing is, Drake does fuck with like battle rapping and stuff like that. So he's very heavy into it.
For sure, he get busy.
Do you get hung up in that realm of the differentiate of being an artist and being a rapper? Is that like a hard thing to fight? In a sense,
it's not a hard thing to fight because of, like I said, the diversity of like what I listen to, what I do on my day to day. I'm always exploring whether it's the internet or whether it's in life. You know, I'm always trying to figure out something new.
Right.
So it's not difficult, but I do get my modes where I just want to be in straight rapper mode, right, and rap my lights out. That's not what the game is right now. So it's easy to stand out, but it's also difficult to reach a peak because people may not have the same tolerance for it, you know? So it's challenging.
Right. Let me ask you a question, like, because you've been rapping for a long time. So is there anything that you can't do anymore but that you wish you could? As far as, like, maybe you always wanted to be on, like, the Soul Train, but, like, Soul Train.
Come aboard the Soul Train.
The Soul Train still on?
No, because, like, there's a lot of things that don't exist anymore. Because when I figure out things have ended, I'm like, damn, I can never do that now.
That was an amazing question. And no one has ever asked me that. And the way you put it, because when you said it, I'm thinking you're saying, like, the ability of what I can't do anymore.
Yeah, no, like, it don't exist.
Listen, I'm a 90s baby. And the fact that 106 and Park doesn't exist. And
that's what I'm saying. Oh my God, that's what I thought about. No.
Yeah. Yo, listen, man.
TRL, like, what the fuck?
But there's other ways now, though.
Rap City. Oh, my.
Yeah.
The basement. Rap City was fire.
No,
basement.
Remember
that's what I do. Yeah. Like, you put a beat on without a beat. Like,
and just tell me to keep going.
I come from that. So, yes, right. Rap City.
So, let's recreate.
Because you know what I was going to say? Like, I remember back in the day, like, Freshman XL, like, people used to go crazy. Like,
you used to work.
You knew you were going to have an amazing career. You knew you were at the top of the top when you were asked to come to Freshman XL.
Facts.
Even though Freshman XL. Yeah. Even though it still exists, it's not like, to me, it's not like how it used to be. Like,
of course. It sounds old.
Or like, even like BET the when they have like the freestyles, like, man, I remember.
Hip-hop cypher.
I used to. It don't matter. That was the only part I really even enjoyed about the show. Exactly. I would watch that shit and just turn the rest off.
Right. Yeah.
But now, I don't even tune in.
We was kids, though. That's why we enjoyed it. So you got respect.
But the bars were.
Was what Stop. It was.
You can't talk to music because I'm always going with music. As music go, I go with it. I love listening to new music. I love kids. I like 16, 17 year olds.
Of course, but being in the past and being now we're in the future.
That's something that could be recreated.
Families did together. Serious. I remember my mom, my dad, brother, sister. We're all watching the BET.
For sure.
We all care about things.
But every
pressure. Quick question. Yes, how you feeling with the? How can I say this? I don't want to call it drill music, but with the Jersey Club on the rap, but New York niggas are killing it right now. When we had that beat. That movement, the sound for so long. Philly niggas are doing it now. They say they claim it. But how you feel about that wave?
Yeah.
I feel like it's our fault.
Why?
Okay.
She's from that way. She's from Hamilton.
She's from
Philly.
Yeah.
She's definitely more of Philly area.
I'm going to tell you why. He brought up a time early in the show about a DJ from up north, right, North Jersey, that was promoting that sound, creating that sound. Him, shout out to my man DJ Lil Man. It's a good amount of them. J Hood, it's a couple that's out there. They were doing that. Shout out to Chad B. I respect everybody. Everybody been doing this for a minute now.
Yeah.
But did the people embrace it? Not really. Don't get me wrong. At that time, social media wasn't crazy. It was MySpace probably around the time.
Right.
But
yeah, you
did
too.
We carry the energy of remaining ourselves and branding it like this? Like, to rap on those type of beats and to make that type of music, it was more for mixtapes and parties. It wasn't for like singles and albums.
Yeah,
when you see, respectfully, Uzi or somebody does that type of joint, we can't say, like, yeah, they stole our style and ramp. First of all,
but you know
right
what Uzi does? He did.
And he acknowledges.
He did. Yeah, he does say that he
took the dude from Newark, right? He took the dude from Newark.
Yeah.
That's his name, Project X.
Yeah.
That's what I'm saying.
He's tough. Little nigga.
If we would have embraced it at the time before the baby and everybody just did it because it was the move, like an artist from here would have popped, and it would have been like, okay, this is our sound. But you gotta think, Jersey also went through this drought where they wanted to sound like everybody from Chi-Raq.
Right.
So true.
Yeah. Drill, that drill movie. Yeah.
Look, and man, look, I talked to the biggest homies, the some of the most popular rappers and politically connected to everybody. It's nothing that I'm saying I'm gonna be challenged on, because everybody know what I'm saying is valid. We messed up because we look at what's hot and we throw our little mix into it, and then we try to make that our style. But the Jersey Club been our style. Y'all, when we was at riding parties, y'all want to hear Jersey Club music or y'all want to hear the regular
music? It's so crazy that everybody calls them riding parties, because we never called
them riding parties. Y'all didn't have riding parties in South Jersey.
We did, but we just called them parties.
No.
It's riding parties, bro.
You don't know. Every guy in here.
Because, we knew we had the people.
Exactly. Yeah. You remember?
Oh, so we was the freak jaws.
Yeah. Y'all was kissing and go. Shit. We just wanted to ride on some ass.
We going in there. If I wear small, I'm wearing a large shirt today.
Exactly.
Bro.
Going up in that joint, facts. I'm pinning myself to the wall, lifting it up with the squat.
You remember that Grace Hall, Oxford days, the center, all that shit. Yeah.
See, I'm from the woods, right? So shout out to my, TJ, man. We had party in the PJs at TJ's.
Right.
Pay $1 to get married.
$1?
He's getting $1 worth in the hood.
See,
high school athletes.
So you gotta understand. We were paying that $1.
Niggas wasn't paying. Like, the shoe was just free. We had people at school, their parents didn't give a fuck. Parents probably
see y'all throwing y'all shit in houses.
Down in South Jersey, that's what we do. The fucking house parties.
Nah,
y'all had the actual teen clubs. We had to make our own.
We didn't even have the. That's the thing. We didn't really
call up Pink Zebra.
The spot. Pink Zebra.
You remember Pink Zebra? Oh my!
What?
Oh, so there used to be a party. It would be like a phone party.
A phone party?
Yeah, but it was like you had to be like 15, we did not 16
have,
to get in.
We had none of that shit.
Yeah.
What?
None of that shit.
No.
It would be at like a different location every time. It was called Pink Zebra. Yup. No, and I always wanted to go, and my mom was like, fuck no, you're never
It's a
going.
Fucking phone party.
No, it would... Oh.
Yeah.
Because it would be a riding party, but it would be...
No. The sketchier the building is, the better, bro. It was the best
situation. Look at the freaks getting busy on the dance floor. Deadass.
Oh, hey. Yo, where is Mono,
bro? Shout out, Ayo. Salute to Grace Hall. Salute to Oxford. Salute to the center, bro.
I remember.
Them shits back in the day was moving. Even the project joints. Even there was plenty of times like... Back in the day, I'm not a project nigga, but I've been times when I said, you know what? And dude, my man, the cameraman, there's been times when we said, fuck it. We ain't banging. Let's go to these project parties. Let's just go there. And we just going to there and then fuck with it. But that's where, and again, what you said, that's where that Jersey Club and that, that beat and that feel started. And then nobody really
embraced it.
True. And again, Little Man, Wala, somebody, we're missing somebody in that shit. Jugs, all these motherfuckers were doing this shit, and then we're just in here, let's do it, let's party, but we're not embracing that shit. And now Philly and all these other motherfuckers,
the Bronx to Brooklyn.
Yeah, all these motherfuckers is picking up on the shit that we've been doing for years.
They took it, they went crazy.
You know, also too, like, people always bring up this conversation about, you know, Jersey don't get burned on New York radio and all that. I hear all of this, right? And I'm being honest, because I'm on both sides of the fence. So I'm able to see it from both sides. I just feel like when Jersey is ready to create their own culture and have their own outlets, then everything will happen the way it's supposed to. You know what I'm saying? Like, people believe, like, yo, get behind one artist and push that guy. Yeah, that could be true. That may make it work. But egos-wise, we know it doesn't work. So... when people like you guys that give an amazing platform for people to open up to the fans, like, you know, y'all helping people see a side of me that, you know, I'm comfortable on this show. When I'm on other shows, I'll be sitting there, I'll be like,
right.
Yo, I honestly, I seen like your other, I'm sorry.
No, go ahead.
No, but I've seen them and I'm like, I was like, damn, this thing gonna open up because like he give me scary vibes. No, because I'm like, nah, we gonna lose this motherfucker up.
But
like,
you got
that Kanye conversation.
Exactly. Respectfully.
I knew he wasn't doing it.
But
no, I did see a couple clips, but I like you. I think you're very professional. But
thank you.
I feel like the ones that I seen, I'm not pointing anybody out in particular.
They didn't pull out.
Yes, I'm like,
I didn't want to say it. I'm glad you said it. I'm glad you said it because I didn't want to say it. So I was being political, and I respect that. But
I'm just chilling.
I don't really know nobody, so I just be like, whatever.
Yeah, that's a no shit.
Yeah, I mean, every platform is different.
True facts.
Everyone's like their target of what they want to go for is different. Some people is
different agendas.
Some people is built on drama. Some people built on it be sexual conversations. Like,
right.
I did a lot of interviews, so they all different. But you know, y'all have a great chemistry. So going back to what I was saying, with y'all creating platforms like this, this is what people need to be embracing versus trying to get an interview on Hot 97 or Power 105. Because the chances of that happening is like almost 1%, unless some other stuff going on that I can't speak about.
Right.
But you know, it'd be a lot of business stuff behind the scenes.
Hey, you need payload.
Yeah, he wants.
Facts.
I mean, you ain't got to say
true.
It.
That's
so
true.
It's a lot of other ways to make things happen, but like I said, I said sorry when we was talking. I said, yo, whatever we post or whatever y'all do, like what I tell you, I say, yo, you send a glad post up.
Yep.
So my fans know what's going on, vice versa. I'm a person that like to help promote people, and I think in Jersey, people only want to. I ain't gonna say in Jersey. Let me not say that. Some artists. That come from a local area get big headed and they just want the bigger stamps of logos and looks. Yeah. But it's like, no, respect everybody the same way.
Facts.
You know what I'm saying?
So I'm so glad you said that because I did have a question. Like, do you feel like back in the day they used to show more love than they do now? Because I remember back in the day, like, you had a hot song or like you come out or even just having potential, everybody wanted to hop on your shit. Everybody was inviting you to hop on their shit. Like,
remix is nice. I want to work with you.
Even if you drop an okay song, you might have like 5 remixes of different people trying to help you get on, trying to learn from you. So like, now that you're in the business, it's 2023. Do you feel like, I don't know, people are like more, or artists are more intimidated by you, especially like coming up, social media is booming right now. And even though you might have a name for yourself, the younger crowd, we're coming up. So what do you feel about that?
I'll be completely honest with you. And this is so funny because I was thinking of this the other day. The only difference from then to now, when you say the difference of how love was shown, This is going to hurt a lot of people's souls right here. I got to say it on this podcast.
Talk about it.
Everybody's fans became the artists. Cheer for you when every... Like, I'm talking about... I used to do open mics when I was younger, right?
Yeah.
And you know you guys have sell 20 tickets, right?
Right.
Yo, about 13, 14 of them rap now. So it's like those people that would come on behalf of them to support me, I'm just hypothetically saying, it wouldn't be the same because it looked funny if, you know what I mean? They ain't one of their boys shows and all like that. Right. Like, it's everybody is not okay with just being a fan anymore. And then let alone social media make everything feel more accessible and more achievable. Yeah. So, yeah, it's I don't think people don't show love because they don't want to. I think they don't have the space to because they like, man, I got my thing.
Yeah.
That's what makes the crab in a bucket effect.
So, exactly. So one of my questions is, and just bringing it back to home base, this is Jersey. Is there a different type of feel for you? Because I can truly say personally, listen to your music, watching your rise and stuff like that, is the support, I guess, like that from behind you, being that you're from Jersey. Is Jersey supporting you, or is it like, yeah, I gotta go to New York?
Where's the majority of your fan base coming from? If you know.
Because I know.
Nah, like, I do know.
Like I said, shout out to Jugs again. Shout out to Jugs and shout out to Wild Out because they are in the trenches. They are Jersey natives and stuff like that. But as far as like the other, because there are a lot of like Jersey people, New Jersey in general, that are relevant, but are they still in your corner or just got your back in the sense of like, okay, we see him doing this thing, let's just get behind him in a sense like that?
I do see that, but I'm going to tell you that the most when I see it is when I get like in my ignorant bag where I'm rapping and I'm just wilding.
That Jersey shit.
That Jersey shit.
So, to be honest, yes, I do feel like I get the support. But there's times that I want to stray away from that and make more commercialized music. Like, when I think of the type of music I want to put out, like, I don't want someone listening to me and saying, yeah, we could hear him on a track with this trap artist or this West Coast artist. Like, I want somebody to say, like, you know what? Him and Jason Derulo might sound dope. Or him and Justin Bieber. Or him and Rihanna. Or, like, I think Z100, like, now. Like, I'm at a different stage in my life where I may not always make the music that attract the people that's around me. That, you know, because you got to think, their circumstances dictate what they like.
Yeah.
So right. If I'm not in that same circumstance due to me figuring out my path, of course, I may not, the music I make might not be as attractive to that same audience. Because sometimes you can outgrow your audience and sometimes they stick with you. But in my case, I do feel like I definitely get the support. But I also feel like my level of diversity is a little abnormal to those that know me. Because people that know you, they think they know you so well that when you change, it's like you're changing on them. But really, you're changing for better. But people can't understand that if they don't, if they're not changing, if they're not growing.
Yeah,
it's tricky. It's a two-way street.
Fucking, yo, I have a fucking question. Actually, this is a serious question, right?
Let's get it.
How do?
you heard how the tone changed.
How do you become a fucking Jets fan, bro?
I thought you about to ask
this. What you guys were thinking that? This is exactly what you guys were thinking. I truly want to know this shit, bro. Because I know you guys are
about to ask about some real life trauma shit.
We got a group chat
with the share. I see him.
He just made that shit up.
I don't know, bro. Listen, I just want to know how that became a thing, bro. All
right, so a little.
Hold on, before you answer that, I caught you at the Jets game, at the Giants game too.
Yeah, so definitely did.
So I respect this question because I kind of want to know the answer too. Because I caught you at the Giants game too, posted up and shit. I seen the little gram, but I didn't want to bring it up. He did. So go ahead, respectfully. Go ahead.
So there's so many spectrums to this, right?
Okay.
One, I'm not a Jets fan.
Okay, cool.
All right, cool. Fair enough.
Now,
shout out to my guy, Arthur Marlett. He was on the Jets when I actually kind of got introduced into the NFL game.
Gotcha.
And I used to do like some camera work for him. I used to help him with his content.
Tough.
He don't play for them anymore. I think he on the Steelers. But the Jets and Giants, they're home team, right?
Of course.
Yes. Yeah.
But I'm not a Jets fan.
Okay.
Just
supporting.
All right, cool.
That
cool,
was the supporting type thing.
Right.
All right, fair.
That's one. Two, as far as the Giants, shout out to DJ Wala. I ain't going to say nobody else because then it's going to put
right.
A different type of conversation. Right.
The Giants do good business.
Copy.
Exactly.
They take care of home.
Right. Shout out to the Giants.
Shout out to the Giants.
Shout out to the Giants.
MetLife, baby.
I'm not a Giants fan.
You're a businessman.
I'm a businessman.
right. Respectfully, too.
Fan on 32.
He said he where the money resides.
Respectfully.
I watch it by the game.
Exactly.
It's about who I think gonna win. That's my team for the night.
Right.
I'm putting my money on them.
Depends. Yeah, the parlays.
The parlays. It's about the parlays. It's about the parlays hitting. It's about the parlays hitting.
No, but you know what? I always thought that because like niggas get traded every day. So like, what if one day your team not fired? You just.
You gotta take that out. That's
you
it.
With
that
the
is,
marriage.
Yeah.
Like,
as it is, bro.
Right. You're right.
I tell you this. My mom's and God rest my step pops. they're Cowboys fans, and they'll be
daddy's a Cowboy fan.
Let me say this. But I'm going to tell you right now. Let's say if I had to choose a team.
Okay.
If.
Yeah.
It would definitely be between the Cowboys and the Eagles.
I knew you were going to say the Eagles. Hey, yo, I knew, bro.
We can cut this shit right now.
We ain't about to do that shit.
Hey, yo.
Sorry. I respect them. Yo, boys, 49ers. Man. I respect them, but listen, I'm sorry.
That's why.
Out of love, so I understand that.
But I do not have a specific team.
Yo, Prezi gonna do the Brian Dawkins shit, bro.
Exactly, I'm about to
ain't
say
no way.
Until Jersey has a team, being that everybody want to play in our state, wink, wink. You know what I'm talking
about? That's wild, too.
Yeah, absolutely.
Then I will have a football team. But
talk about it, bro.
That's for taxes. That's why they play over here in Jersey.
Right. Motherfuckers don't want that New York tax. That New York tax is wicked.
And it's like, come on, y'all got three teams in the NFL. Like, fact. New York, like, what are you doing?
Exactly.
Yeah. In the Bills.
Jets, Giants, Bills.
It's like, give us one.
Where, bro?
Right. Y'all took, damn near took all the stadiums away from it. They done knocked down the Izod Center.
Yeah,
they don't remember the Izod Center when the Nets was playing that.
Hunter, Izod had a center.
That's South Jersey.
Stop, South Jersey, let it come up north. Stop playing. You don't got no club.
You don't got no Jersey. You remember the Nets? The New Jersey Nets?
Vince Carter.
I do remember the New Jersey Nets. Me and my dad, they used to go there.
Exactly.
Don't feel bad. I've heard women say things just like that, so it's okay.
We're going to let it slide.
That's South Jersey shit.
What? If you was a team, that's all I got. Cowboys and Nets. That's all his job.
Fair enough. We take it. I was going to ask you, for you being a team of 32 in a sense, or you know, whoever you got your money on, do you got like a particular person, rather through entertainment or sports, like you like, damn, you know what? I like how he does business, or just admire how that person moves in a sense.
How you do business?
Yeah.
A particular favorite
entrepreneur,
anybody in the business.
Man, I know how this gonna sound because I'm a G and a fan, but I had to say 50.
50?
Yeah, 50 Cent for sure. And shout out to him too, man. I appreciate him. He reposted two videos that I directed.
I peeped that too. Yeah,
what's his name? Yeah, man.
Fire, bro.
I'm thankful. 50. Like, that was great, and met him too. He's a real cool and humble person. Like once he comfortable. Like, yeah, shout out to him.
People looking at 50 crazy, like when he was coming at people back in the days, but now it's starting to make
how to rob.
Now it's a tactic to sell.
Not even a tactic to sell anymore. Now, whoever 50 don't fuck with is for a reason. People always thought 50 was not fucking with niggas just because I'm 50 Cent. But now when you see in the light, 50's doing good. Now he's going at millionaires and billionaires. Like, yo, that nigga's been weird back in the day.
Yep, well, he calls it up, bro. He calls bullshit.
It off the rip, man.
Yeah, he does.
He was always on some.
I respect him because he stand on business. As like, look, man, this is who I am from Southside, and you know he had his ups and downs where, you know he was at the height musically, and then everything else simmered down. But you know, I like when I can see the slopes of people's career. Everything not so perfect. Mm. Like respectfully saying, I hate to bring this. You know,
no, it's cool.
This person up, but like Diddy career has always looked just about perfect.
Yeah.
Like 50, you actually seen like when he did Before I Self-Destruct.
Mm-hmm.
Like you could tell the difference from then to Give It a Shot Trying. It's a difference, you know? I've always respected 50 Moves. I think he's one of the most influential people of our time.
From outside, at least from the Northeast side.
Yeah. I mean, personally, in general, I don't think there's no other artist that made me as a 10-year-old want to wear bulletproof vests.
Like, yeah, right.
Like, tank tops, like, the durag, like, the headband.
I walked out the movie theater from watching
Get Rich or Die Trying.
Dog, I thought I got shot 9 times when I walked out of that theater because I felt the energy of like, yo, this is somebody's life. Like, that's so rare. You know, and then he's selling clothes. And he, you know, he did his liquor run.
Yeah, yep.
He did his
Vitamin water.
He did the book, the audio book.
But you're not comfortable. TV shows. That come from his team, though. Being with Dre, being with Eminem, Jimmy
that's
I,
what
being
I'm saying.
Them niggas was entrepreneurs.
I respect that. And that's not even including, too. Like, you know, it goes under the radar, but he's definitely, you know, put money into other cities and helped with schools and a lot of other things that I personally know just because I follow him. So, yeah, I respect stuff like that, you know. I put this dick in the gun. She drop it low, low, low. Then started picking it up. And I bet she give it up. And I bet she lick it up. Arch on swole, I love when she